This just made sense. Why? Do I need to explain? I feel like those that know me, you know me. If you know, you know. Those that don't, well, you know, you'll learn. It's your boy Just in the building. They let us in the building, y'all. The security let me through, no pat down. You know, they gave the clearance. They let me in, man. I'm here. We are in the studio right now. Episode numero uno of Just Made Sense. Oh uno. I'm your host, Just. I'm ready. I hope y'all ready. I'm ready to have a good time. Ready to talk about some things, have some conversations that need to be had, that should be had. You know, you're in your own space. Might be in your cubicle at work. Might be driving your Prius, you know, to Jamba Juice, you know, whatever it is. You might be at the gym on the treadmill right now, sweating. You might be getting that cardio in. If you are, hey, you know, just watch your step, especially on that Stairmaster. First and foremost, this is something you guys have probably seen in the news as of late, recently. I kind of got onto it a little bit late, but you know, better late than never. And it's the situation over in Thailand. I believe it's like a youth soccer team. I think the kids might be aged like 11 to 13, something like that. But basically, there's this cave passage or pathway. You know, when I think about it, I think of like, you know, Indiana Jones or something. Anyway, there's this cave that they went into in Thailand. He was taking them on some type of journey, you know, trying to teach them something like coaches do. And they got stuck. They got stuck in this cave in Thailand. And it's a long cave. It's like a 7-hour journey or walk. He took them on it. They got to the end and they couldn't get back. And then on top of that, Thailand was expecting like floods or like heavy rain pour. Just rain was supposed to be coming, you know, out from the heavens out of nowhere. And they were stuck. And as of right now, today is July 10th. So as of today, this Monday, it's been like 2 weeks they've been stuck in there. And, you know, they've been trying to get rescuers and people and whatnot. And it's just been tough. It's been tough. And so, I believe as of yesterday, they had got 4 boys out. I know as of today, they got 4 more. So right now it's a total of 8 boys or 8 kids they got out of the cave. But there was 12 in total down there, including the coach. So they still got a few more to go. But this is like a big thing now. Like once it hit the news, that's how I saw it. I saw it on the news. And of course, my news is Twitter. Y'all know that. Very, very active on the Twitter feed and Twitter sphere. So at Just Is Real, you know what it is. But I saw it on there and I was like, yo, this is crazy. This is like your worst nightmare as a Boy Scout or something. And on top of that, I guess they've sent down like 18, you know, divers from Thailand, like rescue divers. They're from Thailand. They sent them down there to try to get the kids out. And one of them died. Like one of them, I guess from what I read or saw, it looked like he got back from checking on them, you know, making sure they got enough oxygen or whatnot. And he like passed out, like collapsed, and he was done. Like, it was over after that for him. So, you know, they're in a very tricky place. But I had to start off the podcast with that just because, you know, my prayers go out to them, their families, especially the kids, man. I mean, like I said, they're not even like high school age. These are like middle school, you know, 7th, 8th grade, you know, around that age kids. And these kids have been stuck in there with no food. You know, I think they might have water, but no food, no snacks, no nothing. You haven't seen their parents in 2 weeks, you know, their family. I mean, you know, in my mind, I'm just like, could you imagine being in that predicament, in that situation? That's like, that's literally being between a rock and a hard place. Like, they're in that hard place right now. And man, I don't know, if it was me at 12 or 13, that's tough, that's rough. I can imagine what their parents are going through, just kind of feeling like, you know, what do we do? Like, we can't, you know, I'm sure they got a feeling of helplessness. Like, we can't really do anything. Our kids are stuck in a cave, you know, with their coach. So they know they are, you know, they're with an adult, but he can't do much. There's not a, you know, there's not a restaurant down there. There's not, you know, a slushy machine or something. They're not, you know, I think some of them, from what I've heard, they're suffering from like dehydration, obviously hunger pains. It's been 2 weeks since they last ate. So the ones that they got out in the videos I saw on Twitter and on the news is, you know, they're getting them in the ambulance and they're rushing them off to, you know, some hospital in Thailand, you know, I'm sure to get them IV'd up to get all that, you know, hydration going and whatnot, and feed them. But definitely keeping them in my prayers. All the boys and all the kids, even the coach on that soccer team, you know, I feel bad for him, because I'm sure he was like, you know, this is a great idea. I want to take the kids on a little journey, you know, show them something real neat, real cool. And, you know, it end up kind of being, you know, like really sad and kind of like a disaster. So I'm hoping, you know, he doesn't, you know, when they do get out, because I do believe they're going to get out. They even got my guy Elon Musk, you know, the guy behind Tesla and all those dope electric cars. I guess he put something together and sent like his research team or something down there. They built some type of machine that you could put somebody in and they could breathe or whatever. So he's helping out, which is dope. But even with all that, you know, I would hate for the coach, you know, to be too hard on himself, you know, to, you know, do something drastic when, you know, hey, life happens, man. I mean, like I said, this is a rocky part of life. You know, these kids are forever going to have this story. You know, they can all go on, you know, whatever TV show, radio, whatever they want, and tell the story about how they survived 2 weeks in a cave in Thailand. But, you know, at the same time, it's like, you know, for me, I'd rather not experience it. You know what I mean? I'm just saying, I don't want to have to go through that just to tell somebody I went through that. But at the same time, you know, these kids, they're like warriors. I mean, so I'm hoping all of them live, you know, after they get their, you know, hospital treatment and, you know, whatever it is that, you know, they need to be 100, but definitely in my prayers for sure. The four boys that got out, and then the four more that they added today that they took to the hospital, and the rest of the team and the coach, definitely hopeful for them. Hopeful that they get out safely and that they can get back to, you know, regular civilian life, as we all like to live. But from that, I'll jump over to the FIFA World Cup. I know a lot of people are watching it. Every time I get on the gram or get on Twitter, it's a video from, you know, the World Cup. It's either Mexico or, you know, what other teams are out there that are real good. People are really rooting for them. Brazil, you know, Neymar is real popular. You know, for me, people that know me, you know, I'm a basketball, baseball guy, you know, track sometimes during the summer. You know, I don't watch a whole lot of football. I do get busy on the Madden. Don't get it twisted. You know, people could take these L's in Madden on the PS4. But other than that, you know, I'm not a big soccer guy. So I haven't really been keeping up with it besides the clips I see on Twitter or in the news. But that's going on. And, you know, one thing I have noticed, and, you know, I might get, you know, you guys might agree or disagree. Let me know. Comment on it. You know, I'm always open for dialogue. But one thing I was thinking about just watching the highlights and whatnot is I would say, I think soccer compared to other sports, you know, where you do, you know, some type of cardio, you know, some type of movement, you know, football or, you know, I don't know what else is that, baseball, where you run a little bit. I think you might have to be like the best shape of your life to play soccer. Like, and this is no diss for other sports, because like I said, I played basketball growing up. I still play, you know, at the gym and whatnot, or on the weekends. Even football players. I got a lot of friends that play football. I got relatives that played NFL and friends that, you know, have been drafted. And so this is no, you know, no diss on them. But I think out of all sports, you have to be literally in the best shape to play soccer. Because if you think about it, at least from the highlights I've seen and what I know of it, and, you know, seeing people play it within high school or college or whatever, it's like, you move nonstop. And for people like me, that's a problem, because I don't want to move nonstop. I want to slow down. I want to, you know, and for me, every once in a while, at least watching it, you know, you see a player jog a little bit, or you see, you know, but I don't think I've seen a soccer player walk in seeing any of these highlights or any of, you know, when someone has the game on. I'm like, nah, these dudes are, and even the ladies that play, you know, whenever, you know, their season is, it's like a nonstop sport, man. Like, I see why, you know, that they're cut up, or, you know, their thighs look like, you know, they just booming. I'm like even for track, you know, you run your little 100 sprint, you know, that's over. You dust somebody, that's it. You know, you run the 200. And then even like the long, you know, track events, like, I don't know, is the 800 that might be long, like four laps or something. My math is not, that wasn't my best subject growing up, so forgive me on that. But you know what I mean? Like, you know, even after the race is done, like, it's over. You know what I mean? Like, you do your race, you run your laps, and that's it. Even with a marathon, you know, once you get to the finish line, you know, it's over. But for me, I'm like, soccer, like, yo, like, you are really moving like the whole game. And like, unless you come out, you know, to get some Gatorade or something, that's you really moving around. So that was the only thing I really took away from all these highlights and, you know, everybody talking about, you know, who's playing good, who's not playing good. And, you know, I know a few people out there, I'm not gonna say no names, you know, making some money off, you know, a few bets here and there, you know, just cause they think they got the, you know, the knowledge of who's better and whatnot. But yeah, my takeaway is, man, you got to be in good shape to play soccer, man. And like I said, I remember playing at a young age, you know, in elementary school, early in the morning before school starts, before that bell rings, or playing at lunch, getting all dusty, you know, messing up my Nikes or whatever I was wearing at that time, you know, to go out there and play soccer with the kids who are obviously much better than me, you know, but they couldn't see me on the court because, you know, that's where I rule, you know, the buckets. That's all I got to say. Y'all know. But yeah, soccer, you know, I was all right. I enjoyed it just because it was fun. You know what I mean? Just running around and, you know, you could bump into people and slide and, you know, whatever. But, you know, I just think, yeah, for soccer, man, you got to be in, you know, crazy cardiovascular shape just to keep it moving. Like, I'm impressed by that. Just, you know, me being somebody who, you know, I take pride in fitness. I don't try to let myself get too out of whack. You know what I'm saying? I like to look good. But for me, soccer, you know, I'm cool on that. But like I said, a lot of people watching it, you know, I don't really have a horse in the race. I don't have a team that I'm rooting for, but you know, it's the World Cup. People are paying attention to it. I think it happens, what, every, you know, 2 years or whatever, how many, just like the Olympics, it only happens every so often. So, you know, it's going to be in the news and trending or whatever, but you know, obviously I had to touch on the World Cup because, you know, how lame would I be to have a podcast and I don't talk about stuff that's relevant. Black excellence alert. Black excellence alert. Black man on the microphone about to make a statement about black excellence. This moment comes to us via the NBA, one of my favorite leagues, favorite things to watch. I've been watching basketball since I was a kid and been playing it since then as well. But all right, here's the report. I'm gonna read the headline to you guys, and then I'll go in detail on what I thought about it. But basically, this past week, I believe it was last Tuesday, which would have been, I think, the day before the 4th of July. Yeah, July 3rd. Yeah. That sounds about right. For the first time ever, two women, they were referees in an NBA game. Now these were summer league games. Obviously the season's over. You know, the Warriors beat LeBron and them in the finals. But right now it's the Summer League. For those that don't keep up with NBA or basketball, period, Summer League is, you know, a lot of the rookies, new guys, you know, maybe guys who don't play a lot during the season. You know, they work it out during the Summer League, you know, get to show the coaches that, you know, they can get a few buckets here and there, or that they deserve a big contract or some coins, you know what I'm saying? Got to get the bag. That's what the Summer League is for. And I think it lasts for, I don't know, maybe a month or two. I'm not sure. But yeah, that's what the Summer League is for. And that's what it's about. And so these two refs, they were reffing these Summer League games. And I guess it got a lot of attention. That's what I, you know, when I saw the article online, I was like, wow, what's so big about this? And the reason the game got so much attention was because the two refs, one, they were both women. So that's already a big up, you know, shout out to the women out there doing the thing. And on top of that, there were two black women. There were two African-American women. And so people were taking pictures and videos. And that's how I saw it on, I think it was Twitter I saw it on. And I was like, you know, what's the deal? Like, why are all these people, you know, why are these pics and videos going around? And what happened is this was the first time ever in an NBA game, NBA, you know, type game, NBA official game, period, that two women were refs in a game. And on top of that, it was the first time two black women were refs in a game. So when I saw that, I was like, oh man, I got to talk about this. Me, come on now. I got Black Panther blood in me. And this is before the movie, by the way. I'm talking about real Black Panther blood. You know, my grandmother, you know, from the Bay Area, you know, it's real. It's real out here. Just know, just as legit what it is, just as real. So yeah, man, I got that in me, and y'all know I'm all about, you know, my people and whatnot, and, you know, the natural and, you know, what we got going on. So when I saw that, I was like, oh yeah, that's what you call black excellence right there. So I was like, you know what? I gotta talk about that. Cause, you know, on one side, like I said, it's dope because it's two women, you know, reffing an NBA game, even though it's summer league, it's still an NBA game. And then on top of that, the two black women, man, they're minorities, the African-American, you know, these are my people. These is, you know, the queens, you know, they out there getting paid, making that coin, getting the bread. And, you know, they, you know, it's the NBA, it's official. It's not, you know, a Harlem Globetrotters game or, you know, something like that. This is official. This is the top league in, you know, probably all of the world, but America for sure. So I got to give props to them. The two women that reffed, the names, one is Danielle Scott. So shout out to Danielle. Hey, Danielle. And then the second one is Angelica Suffren. But shout out to y'all, man. Y'all doing the thing. Keep on doing it. That's lovely to see. And I hope to see more of that, honestly. I mean, you know, we all know how it goes, but at the same time, you know, it's always great to see, you know, leagues or, you know, companies or whatever it is that are inclusive, that, you know, it's not just, you know, men running the whole operation or the business, or it's not just one, you know, vice versa, you know, everybody's included. And so I think that's great. So on top of that, you know, like I said, women out there doing their thing and, you know, what they would call a men's league or a man's league, whatever you want to call it. And on top of that, like I said, they're black African-American women. So, you know, props to them. Shout out to Danielle and Angelica. I'm sorry. Shout out to Danielle and Angelica doing the thing. Y'all keep on doing that. 92-year-old Arizona woman arrested for shooting son.
You have got to be kidding me right now.
Okay. I'm going to read that one more time just because when I saw it, I was like, what? Huh? 92-year-old Arizona woman arrested for shooting son. So when I read that, I clicked on, I think it was NBC News or something was reporting it. Somebody retweeted or whatever. But I clicked on it because the pic that they had with the article was like the mugshot of this 92-year-old lady. And I was just like, man, that's crazy to see, you know, someone elderly, you know, someone that's in their senior years, you know, they've seen a lot. They've been on planet Earth for a minute now. You know, they've been here, you know, to see that kind of headline associated with somebody of that age. You know, you gotta check that out. I can't, what, I'm supposed to scroll past that? Nah, fam. So yeah. So when I clicked on it, what happened was her son, you know, he might be 40 something, 50 something, wanted to put her in an old folks home, you know, I don't know the name for it. I'm not fancy like that, but you know, whatever the name is for an old folks home, he was trying to put her in there. Basically like, you know, mom, you know, you're 92, you're getting close to that 100 range. You gotta go. You gotta, and just, you know, just for the record, I'm one of those people that I could never see myself, you know, putting my, parents in something like that. You know, those are just, that's just me. You know, my parents, you know, obviously without them, there's no me. And, you know, they raised me, you know, and I would say the right way. And, you know, I don't know, man. I couldn't see letting other people, you know, like control my parents or like, you know, especially in, you know, in upper age, like to me, it's almost like your kids, like, you know, for people that have kids or, you know, children or whatnot, you don't just let everybody babysit your kids or let everybody. Now, some of y'all do, you know, I'm not saying who, you know, you know, if it's you, then it's you. If not, you know, we'll keep it moving. But, you know, most people, you know, they don't let everybody babysit their kid. You know, they don't let everybody hold their kid or, you know, that's just, and really it's safe. You know, obviously germs out there, people are sick and there's people that are sick in the head. It's just crazy. You don't know what they're going to do when they, you know, get their child. But for me, that's how I look at it. Like, you know, if my parents were to be in an old folks home, like obviously I could check on them, you know, I could drop them off, you know, food or whatnot and, you know, visit and take them out places. But in my mind, I'm like, you know, those are my parents, man. Like, you know, they didn't do that when they were raising me. They didn't drop me off somewhere and say, all right, we're going to have this person, you know, potty train you. And, you know, but like I said, everybody, you know, different strokes for different folks, you know, everybody, you know, they're entitled to their own. But, so I'm obviously, I would say, you know, allegedly, cause you know, I don't think she's been to court yet, but this lady, that shot her son, that was the motivation. Like that's what they have in the statement as far as like, you know, I guess, you know, obviously they asked the lady, you know, why'd you shoot your son? And that was the reason, you know, he was going to try to put her in an old folks home. And from what I read, he had been trying for a long time. And she was like, nah, I'm not going. I'm here at the crib. I'm not bouncing. And so I don't know what type of gun she used, but you know, she pulled out the blammy, you know what I'm saying? Pulled out the hammer and let one off or let a few off, and they were fatal shots. The man died. She killed her son. Like that's what was crazy. Like the headline got me as far as, you know, him being shot, because you know sometimes you hear crazy stories like this, like out of Florida, you know, or Arizona, like where she's at. These states were just kind of like Texas, you know, with the laws, like, you know, they're a little bit different from everywhere else. You know, me being a California resident, you know, whenever I do travel, you know, it's always good to be aware of the laws, you know, regulations, policies, all that, whenever you land somewhere, because, you know, you never know, you know, things could pop off. And it's like, ooh, I ain't know that, you know, you could do this or you can't do that. But I know in, you know, states like that, you know, that are a little bit different than California or New York, you know, what I'm used to. Yeah, man, they got some different laws out there. They got some different, you know, things you got to go by. And like I said, this lady, 92. And see, this is what I want to know. Maybe it'll develop. I got to Google it probably, or look up the article, or, you know, see what happens. Because she is arrested. She is in custody. But as far as her killing her son, it doesn't say, like, if she was trying to, because, you know, okay, it's bad either way, right? Like, there's no way I could spin this and make it, you know, seem like this is a good thing. But I do kind of want to know, like, was her intentions to kill him, or, you know, was she trying to, like, aim for a leg or a knee or an elbow? Because, you know, you hear about that type of stuff, like, you know, in movies or something, with, you know, they might, you know, pop somebody and, you know, they only did it just to, you know, get them to, you know, go down or something. And then they call the police. So then they, you know what I'm saying? Like that happens, you know, that people do that just to subdue you for a second. It's kind of like the effect that, what is that the police use? A stun gun or a taser, whatever that thing is called. You know, it's not, I don't think tasers were invented, you know, to kill people. You know, it's obviously something to shock you, you know, and kind of put you in a state where, like, you can't move, you can't do anything. And now they could, you know, put the cuffs on you, or, you know, whatever it is. So that's what I want to know. Like, if they get a statement, or if they, you know, have a camera in the courtroom, I want to hear, you know, did this 92-year-old lady, did she really want to, you know, be lethal with it and kill her son? Or, you know, was she, you know, like I said, was her aim off? You know, did she got arthritis and the gun shook or something? Like, what happened? Because, I mean, you know, we all know, you know, like, the love that mothers have for their children. You know, we know that, you know, your mom loves you, man. Or, you know, there's always a connection to the mother, no matter what it is. It could be in people, man. It could be in Labrador retrievers, you know, rabbits, whatever. There's always that, you know, mother to, you know, child, mother to seed, you know, connection. So for a mother, you know, to shoot and kill her own son, you know, I kind of want to know, like, how bad was their relationship? And, you know, I could be overanalyzing, but, you know, for me, when I see something like that kind of stands out, that's a little bit interesting. It's like, yeah, let's read that. You know, I want to, you know, that's something, you know, when you're out, you know, that's a conversation piece right there. That's an article that, you know, you don't just pass up. It's like, you know, it's like the OJ, you know, case or something. It's like, people are going to talk about this, so I might as well talk about it. And yeah, man, that's, you know, that's crazy. So I'm going to try and keep up with it. I want to see what happens. You know, I want to see all that, cause they didn't say, you know, if she going to, you know, prison for life, you know, they're going to lock her up and throw away the key. Like, cause I always, it's interesting to me, what do you do, you know, when somebody at this age commits a crime? You know what I mean? Like 92, like you're going to lock them up for how long, you know? Or are you going to give them a life sentence for, you know, without parole? Like what happens after this? Cause, you know, I feel like every once in a while, something like this happens. You know, you hear about it in the news, you know, whatever the case may be, somebody older, you know, much older, you know, as in like past 60, they, you know, 70 plus, they 70 and up. And, you know, they just got locked up, you know, they just got caught up in something. And it's like, okay, you're going to send this person to prison for what, for how long? You're gonna let this person die and rot in a cell? Or you're going to put them on, you know, house arrest or, you know, community service for the rest of their life? Like, how do you, you know, I would hate to be the judge or the person in charge of, you know, putting that down. Cause it's like, you know, what do you do? Like, you know, at the same time, they did do wrong. You know, that lady should not have shot her son. She shouldn't have pulled a gun on him. Shouldn't have, you know, yapped him, nothing like that. But, you know, at the same time, it's like, you killed your son. Like, sis, like, you, that's what we doing out here. We can't, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, it's like, what do you do? But, you know, we'll see what happens. If I can follow it, you know, I'll have an update on the next episode or something. But it is what it is. Just Made Sense. You know, at Just Is Real on Twitter and Instagram. That's at Just, J-U-S underscore is underscore real. Because Just is real. Like I said, shout out to the homies that gave me that nickname back in high school. And, you know, that's been my socials ever since then. So at Just Is Real, Twitter, Instagram. That's really about it for the most part that I'm on. And yeah, catch me there. Hit me up. Slide my DMs. Whatever y'all want to do. Let's make it do what it do, what it do. You know what I'm saying? If you're not keeping it real, learn how to. Always make your next move your best move. You know, we out here. Official like a referee with a brand new whistle. It's Just Is Real. Just Made Sense. I'm out.